committee will come to order. Let me welcome our members, witnesses, and guests for this hearing on how the Department of Defense is responding to emerging security challenges in Europe. In a world and a time full of complex threats facing the United States, it seems to me the situation in Europe poses peril on several levels. One is naked aggression of conquest. We've seen this before in Europe many times in the past, and it seems to me if history has taught us anything, it is that aggression unchallenged in its early stages leads to greater costs and greater misery when it must be confronted. A second element is what I believe is an attempt to undermine the rules-based international system that has existed since the end of World War II. I'm among those who is convinced that President Putin is working to undermine that system in order to replace it with one that is more of his liking. And unfortunately, he has some unsavory allies in that effort. A third challenge are the tactics that the Russians are using in Ukraine. We've heard a lot about little green men, but the various efforts Russia is using to undermine Ukrainian security forces, as well as to pull a facade over its own involvement, presents a number of challenges to NATO and to the United States. We tend not to deal with naked lies and subversion and other forms of subterfuge very easily. I'm pleased to be supporting Mr. Smith's legislation that would provide defensive lethal assistance to Ukraine. It seems to me that any people ought to be able to defend themselves and their country. But beyond the immediate crisis, part of what this committee needs to think about as we consider funding, organizing, and equipping our troops is how well we're prepared to deal with this sort of threat in Europe and elsewhere. As Europe and NATO grapple with this crisis, as well as the growing threat of jihadi terrorists, the world is watching and will draw conclusions about what course they will take in response. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And obviously, that is the game-changing issue in the European command, Russia, and President Putin's aggressiveness in the Ukraine. And I think the chairman summed it up fairly well. What Mr. Putin is trying to do is fundamentally alter the post-World War II construct in terms of how the world is organized. And it is very unfortunate. You know, when the Soviet Union broke up and the Cold War ended, there was a real opportunity to integrate Russia into that world order, which has worked reasonably well. And Russia would have been a great partner, and, you know, history can be written about why that didn't work out. But the bottom line is Russia is now attempting to set up again a bipolar world. They see it as a zero-sum game. What's good for the West is not good for them. And they are attempting to reestablish their power and break away as many people as possible from Western influence. And that's bad enough. Worse is that they are aggressive militarily in how they go about trying to do that. We've seen it in Crimea, we've seen it in eastern Ukraine, and the real concern is you read about how Russia's top leadership looks at this issue, there's really not much reason to believe that they're going to stop. They believe this sort of aggression has been rewarded, that they have been able to take territory, that they have been able to reestablish themselves as a legitimate power on the world stage. So confronting that threat is the number one biggest issue, and it's not easy to confront. We do not want to start another war. We want to figure out some way to stop this aggression in a peaceful means. And we have to work with our NATO and European partners in order to achieve that. And, you know, that's not always an easy process either. But it does also raise questions about something that I think this committee had long assumed was that we could afford to substantially draw down our presence in Europe. In order to focus, whether it was on the pivot to Asia or to focus on the rising tide of Islamic extremists in various countries and confronting the terrorist threat that that presents, now we realize that our presence in Europe is more important than it used to be. So we'll be interested to hear how are we properly positioned in Europe to confront this threat. How are we aligned with our European allies to hopefully maximize our assets and theirs put them together in the best way possible. And what is the most logical way to confront Putin's aggression? I think that's the fundamental and central question that we face in Europe. I look forward to the testimony. I apologize. I may have to leave a little early. I'm still, as I say, I'm in between hip surgeries. Good news is my left hip's getting a lot better. Bad news is my right hip's getting a lot worse. But the surgery has got me. So sitting for extended periods of time is not something I can do. So I may not be here for the whole hearing, but I do look forward to the testimony and the questions. Thank you.
Thank you. We're pleased to welcome Ms. Christina Wormuth, Undersecretary of Defense for Policy, and General Philip Breedlove, Commander Supreme Allied Command Europe and U.S. European Combatant Command. Thank you all for being here. Without objection, your full written statement will be made part of the record, and we would invite you to make what oral statements you would like at this point. Ms. Wormuth.
Thank you, Chairman Thornberry and Ranking Member Smith and distinguished members of the committee. I very much appreciate the opportunity to be with you all today to talk about the security situation in Europe and our relationship with allies and partners in the region. As both of you have noted, in the last 18 months, the security situation in Europe has changed quite significantly. But despite these challenges, Europe is a cornerstone of our engagement with the rest of the world and a catalyst for our global cooperation. Time and again, Europe and NATO have proven to be our indispensable strategic partners. We believe that will continue to be true, and for these reasons, U.S. engagement in Europe is and will remain a vital element of our national security strategy. It's been almost a year since Russia's occupation and attempted annexation of Crimea. Since that time, we've seen Russia funding and arming separatists in eastern Ukraine. We've seen direct Russian participation in the fighting. These actions, coupled with Russia's continued support of frozen conflicts elsewhere, and violations of its obligations under numerous treaties are undermining European stability. Russia's actions to undermine the sovereignty of a neighboring country and to attempt to change borders and to change the international order even, but certainly to change borders by force, are unacceptable. Russia's aggression against Ukraine challenges our vision of a Europe whole and free, which is what we've been working so hard on since the end of the Cold War. It changes Europe's security landscape. It's causing instability, obviously, on NATO's borders. And we are steadfast as a nation in opposing Russia's destabilizing actions. To do that, we have been working closely with Europe and other partners and allies, first and foremost to impose real costs on Russia for its aggressive actions. This has included diplomatic isolation and economic sanctions, which combined with falling oil prices are having a substantial and mounting impact on Russia's economy. We're also taking visible, concrete measures to reassure our allies and partners in Europe and to deter further Russian aggression. For example, since May 2014, NATO has been reassuring allies and deterring Russia by maintaining a continuous land, air, and maritime presence and increasing military activity, particularly in the eastern part of the NATO alliance. These measures are defensive, they're proportionate, and they're fully in line with our obligations as NATO members regarding allied defense. We are also, as part of our strategy, providing substantial support to Ukraine as it's dealing with simultaneous economic and military crises. Since the start of the crisis, we have increased our security-related assistance to Ukraine significantly, to both its military, its National Guard, and its Border Guard services. And together, next year, in FY15, DOD and the State Department will be providing $120 million to Ukraine as part of the European Reassurance Initiative. But it's, I think, important to also remember that NATO and our European allies are also on the front lines of the fight against ISIL. There, the United States has been leading a coalition of over 60 nations across multiple lines of efforts, ranging from military contributions to humanitarian assistance. As part of the coalition military campaign, Europe has been stepping up to fill critical roles, particularly in denying ISIL's safe haven in Iraq and Syria, and helping us build the capacity of partners to take the fight to ISIL, including by actively striking ISIL targets. The threat we see of foreign fighters going into Iraq and Syria remains a significant concern for us and for our European allies. We are drawing on all forms of our intelligence to understand and address the flow of foreign fighters, and we are working closely with our NATO allies and other partners to have an international effort to try to combat this complex problem. In addition to the threat of ISIL, it's also, I think, important to note that there is significant instability in the Middle East and North Africa that also affects NATO security, especially for those allies that are on the southern flank of the alliance. The movement of thousands of migrants to the shores of southern Europe can bring instability and sometimes violence, particularly because of the transnational criminal networks that are involved in human trafficking. Finally, as we look beyond Europe, it's also useful to reflect on the true strategic partners we have in our European NATO allies for a host of challenges that are well outside of NATO's boundaries. In particular, I just wanted to note how effectively we work together with NATO allies in Africa to be part of the international community's response to the Ebola crisis. Under Operation United Assistance, the Department has supported the USAID-led effort to break the back of the Ebola outbreak, with the United States focusing primarily in Liberia. This mission isn't complete, and many lives have been lost, but I think we can be proud as part of the international community with the strong roles that we've played and that European allies have played to successfully mobilize all of our capabilities to address the emergency. Also in Afghanistan, NATO allies remain our steadfast partners in the effort to try to help bring stability and security to that country. The Resolute Support Mission, which we launched at the beginning of this year, focuses the efforts of our NATO allies and other partners on training, advising, and assisting the Afghan security institutions at both the ministerial and institutional level. 26 of our allies and 16 partners are providing forces to the Resolute Support Mission, and our allies there have also committed to providing sustainment funding to the Afghan National Security Forces through 2024, which is going to be critical to locking in the gains that we're making there. Finally, to do all of this together with our NATO allies and to be able to work effectively, it's essential to have a robust force posture in Europe. Our U.S. footprint in Europe gives us the capability to defend our security interests, to enhance transatlantic security, to reassure allies, and deter aggression, which again, we certainly see in a very marked way in recent times. In a time of limited resources, however, the United States has to be more innovative and explore new posture arrangements by increasing our flexibility, our adaptability, and our readiness. If sequestration returns, however, and this is something I'm very personally concerned about, our ability to sustain our posture in Europe is going to be at significant risk. If sequestration returns, our ability to continue to invest in the capabilities we need and to maintain the readiness levels we need to be able to effectively respond to crises is going to be at significant risk. This is a very serious concern. I know it's one that many of you share, and we look forward to working with this committee and with Congress more broadly to try to find solutions to these budgetary pressures so that we can maintain the U.S. military as the world's finest military force. Thank you very much for your time today and look forward to questions.
Thank you. General?
Chairman Thornberry, Ranking Member Smith, distinguished members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify today. It's an honor to appear before you representing the dedicated soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines, and our civilians of U.S. European Command. Thank you for all you do to support them as they serve our nation. I'm particularly happy to be here today with Undersecretary of Defense for Policy, Christine Wormuth. Compared to just 1 year ago, Europe faces a very different and much more challenging security environment. Our top concern is a resurgent Russia, a Russia attempting to exercise power and influence through the use of force and intimidation. Russia is blatantly challenging the rules and principles that have been the bedrock of European security for decades. The challenge is global, not regional, and enduring, not temporary. Russian aggression is clearly visible in its illegal occupation of Crimea and in the continued armed conflict in the Donbas or eastern Ukraine. The best way to bring the conflict in Ukraine to an acceptable, lasting solution is through a political settlement, one that respects state sovereignty and territorial integrity. But what we have seen recently, and frankly over the course of the whole conflict, gives us cause for concern. Russian forces have supplied separatists with heavy weapons, training and mentoring, command and control, artillery fire support, tactical and operational level air defenses. More than 1,000 pieces of Russian military equipment have been transferred into Ukraine, including tanks, armored personnel carriers, heavy artillery pieces, and other military vehicles and equipment. And in a number of cases, when the separate offensive or operations were stalled or were threatened, Russian regular forces themselves intervened to right the course. Just this month, Russian forces fought hard to change the facts on the ground just before the ceasefire was scheduled to take effect. These are not the actions of a good faith negotiating partner. Actions matter much more than words. And what we see in the fight on the ground and in the diplomatic efforts designed to resolve it is a revanchist Russia that does not play by international rules or norms. The crisis in Ukraine affects more than just Ukraine. Russian activities are destabilizing to neighboring states and to the region as a whole. Russian illegal actions push instability closer to the boundaries of NATO. As President Obama has clearly stated, the United States will uphold its Article 5 commitments under the Washington Treaty. In turn, Russia is learning lessons from our responses to their actions. If they feel rewarded by the outcomes, this might embolden them to try them again elsewhere. And the rest of the world, states and non-state actors alike, are also keeping eyes on how these events unfold. For the longer term, it makes sense to aim for a new Russia-U.S. relationship and a new NATO-Russia relationship that are based on mutual respect and shared interest. A Europe whole, free, at peace, and prosperous is a vision that would benefit everyone, and it would offer the best possible long-term protection of U.S. national security interests. At the same time, Europe also faces a surge of violent extremism. The executions and other brutal actions that ISIL has carried out show their total disregard for human life. European nations are rightly worried about foreign fighters returning home to Europe from the fight in Syria and Iraq, with new skills and with malign intent. Attacks like those in France, Belgium, and Denmark are only likely to become more frequent. Foreign fighters are part of a much broader pattern of insecurity in Europe South, with its roots in the Middle East and North Africa, with flows of migrants and criminal transit routes. The spread of instability into Europe and the reach of transnational terrorism could have a direct bearing on the national security and the U.S. homeland. These challenges are transnational. To solve them, nations need to work together, and our civilian and military institutions are and need to continue to cooperate. EUCOM is working with European nations bilaterally and supporting NATO alliance initiatives to meet and counter this new and more complex security environment. Based on the decisions made at NATO's Wales Summit last year, the alliance is adapting in order to improve its readiness and responsiveness. The Readiness Action Plan, or RAP, is well underway. Our allies are stepping up, making contributions and investments that give them a real stake in the outcome. The United States will have a key and sustained role to play, supporting and enabling these changes, especially in critical areas that are the hardest for our allies to provide, like lift, sustainment, and enablers such as ISR. At the same time, our own U.S. efforts in Europe remain utterly essential, more important now than at any time in recent history. With Russian troops illegally occupying Crimea, soldiers from the 173rd Airborne Brigade in Europe deployed to the Baltic states and Poland with only 96 hours notice to reassure our allies. And our Air Force began flying missions out of Poland within 18 hours of notice. The reason that we could respond so quickly is that we were there, forward and ready. There is simply no substitute for our forward force presence in Europe. It is the bedrock of our ability to assure our allies, to deter real and potential adversaries, and to act in a timely way should deterrence fail. That forward force presence ensures that EUCOM can play a full array of essential supporting roles for other combatant commands, from neighboring AFRICOM and CENTCOM to STRATCOM and TRANSCOM. And it supports all the other critical facets of UCOM's mission, including, very importantly, fulfilling our commitment to the defense of Israel. Rotating presence is no substitute for permanent forward presence in the building of relationships or signaling of our commitment, but genuine and fully funded rotational presence can play a very important role in helping to meet requirements in our theater if it is heel to toe and fully resourced. The budgetary challenges and resourcing trade-offs that we face now based on the Budget Control Act have already forced UCOM to assume risk. Our timelines are longer, our preparations are less robust, and our fundamental ability to deter and defeat in a timely and effective manner is less sure than it could be. The security challenges in and around Europe are only growing sharper and more complicated at the same time. Your support of UCOM's mission and your efforts to chart a longer-term path toward properly resourcing defense are critical steps to ensuring the ability of UCOM to protect and defend its nation and do its mission. Thank you for your time and your attention, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you. Thank you both for your testimony. General Breedlove, you heard me mention at the beginning that I support Mr. Smith's legislation that would require defensive lethal assistance be provided to the Ukrainians. Have you provided options to the administration for various kinds of weapons and equipment that could be provided to the Ukrainians that would make a significant difference in their ability to defend themselves? And part B is, if a decision were made, how long would it take to get it to them?
Chairman, thank you for the question. And these are important things, especially the second part as it relates to how this would play out. So what we have seen across the last year in discussing these issues with Ukraine is a very consistent picture of the things that they tell us they need to move forward in their struggle. Additionally, the U.S. European Command has had a series of broad and deep conversations across all of the aspects of military business with the Ukrainian military and their defense ministry. And what we have observed about Ukraine is very consistent with what Ukraine was telling us about Ukraine. And so, Chairman, I have advised to my chain of command those things that we have learned in these discussions and talked about categories of things that the Ukrainians would need. All of these options have timelines. Some timelines are short and some are longer. It's pretty straightforward. Small arms and some of the other things that you might consider are a very short timeline. Longer, more sophisticated capabilities take training, they take delivery, et cetera. So there is a mixed bag, I think is the best way to answer your question, of not only delivery, but training required to bring things to fruition.
And I appreciate the point about training. Obviously, that takes some time. I'm also remember that in this room just a couple weeks ago, we had the King of Jordan, who said that he is incredibly frustrated when equipment and weapons he's requested have been approved, but our own bureaucracy still takes so long to actually get the things delivered. And so my offer to you is that I hope a decision is made one way or another soon if there's something that we can do to speed delivery once that decision is made, whether we force it or the president decides on his own, then we want to do that. Ms. Warmoth, let me just ask you briefly. This administration, probably before your time, made a big deal about a reset of Russia, of relations with Russia. Even the policy folks in the administration admit that didn't really work out very well, right?
Chairman, what I would say is the reset policy did bear some fruit. For example, we were able to successfully negotiate with the Russians at that time the New START Treaty, which was very much in our interest as well as being very much in Russia's interest, and they are continuing to comply with that treaty. We also were able to cooperate with them to maintain the northern distribution network, which we very much needed to achieve our objectives in Afghanistan. But I would certainly say that at this time, we are much more in a posture of needing to reassert the importance of deterrence and our Article 5 obligations with NATO vis-a-vis Russia.
Well, I appreciate it. I think, as you know, we will have continuing conversations about whether Russia is meeting its arms control obligations across the board, and I think there's considerable doubt about that. But that's for another time. Ms. Sanchez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you both of the witnesses for being before us. I was just in for a NATO parliamentary meeting, and I was in Turkey with Mr. Turner and Colonel Cook, so I won't ask a lot of questions, but I do have a couple of them. The first one is this whole issue of trying to counter ISIS recruiting through the social media, especially to the young people who we see going. What is the military and how are we working with our European allies in particular to ensure that this recruitment isn't going on, not just in the United States, but of course in Europe? And then my second question would be with respect to Turkey, who we know at this point is a key NATO ally, has been for a while. We've had our ups and downs in that relationship. It's alarming to see recent reports of the Turkish government turning a blind eye to arming some of the extremist groups like al-Nusra, and some of these reports even suggest that they help groups to capture Syrian town from the Syrian army with the use of artillery to move in and out across the Turkish border, etc. So while we're all concerned about ISIS and its great cancer in the region, groups like al-Nusra and its allies are not far behind from that. So can either of you comment about what we're seeing there on the ground and what we intend to do about it? Thank you.
Congresswoman, on the issue of ISIL recruiting and their very effective use of social media, it is certainly, ISIL has been remarkable in its effective use of social media, and we are working very hard as a whole-of-government effort to try to be more agile in countering that. And it really is, first and foremost, the center of gravity on that really needs to come from within the region and come from figures that have credibility with the Muslim community. And so in many cases, the Department of Defense is playing more of a supporting role in trying to counter those recruiting efforts. But what we are trying to do, I mean, a lot of what makes ISIL effective with its recruiting, unfortunately, is its very barbaric ideology and the fact that they have been, up until recently, able to demonstrate progress on the battlefield, and they've sort of used that momentum to make themselves attractive to potential recruits. To try to counter that in the department, we are working already, but want to do a better job of being able to show the successes that the coalition and the Iraqi forces are having on the ground. Again, to try to counter ISIL's message that they have the momentum. And the fact that the Kurdish forces in Kobani, for example, were able to defeat ISIL, you know, we were able to make very good use of that, for example. And again, in some of the recent operations in northern Iraq, where we've seen the Peshmerga in particular make progress, we want to try to leverage that from the military perspective to try to blunt the effectiveness of ISIL's use of social media for recruiting.
Right. That might require maybe an off-to-the-side conversation at some point about what we're really doing. The last question, of course, General, Turkey, these other groups, slippery border, arming. I have some of my constituents of Turkish descent coming in with pictures of ISIL-type people with armaments stamped Turkish Army. What's going on there?
Congresswoman, thank you. I am not personally aware of what you have talked about, but what I will do is go back and take a hard look at this and offer to come to you in a classified engagement. I would tell you that you and I have actually talked about this before. Turkey is a great mill-to-mill ally, and that's where I'm focused. Our mill-to-mill relationship is as good as it's ever been, and I think you're aware we've had a few successes this week in things that we've asked of them to move forward, both in Syria and Turkey. But allow me to take the real meat of your second question and come back to you.
Thank you. Mr. Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Madam Secretary, General Breedlove, thank you for being here and your service to our nation. Madam Secretary, you were mentioning in some of your comments about sequestration, and we have heard this before from outside think tanks who had testified, as well as military and administration officials like yourself. I think we all know that we are looking at some major, major decisions forthcoming. My concern is that it's almost like we know that we have a problem, but we're not willing to deal with the problem. General Breedlove, I've great respect for all of our military services. I know the stress you all have been under as it relates to budgets. And this brings me to the point I'm trying to make. First of all, Madam Secretary, has this administration brought in inspector generals like John Sopko to talk about the waste, fraud, and abuse in Afghanistan? You made mention in your comments that things in Afghanistan, we're going to be there to 2024. That's the agreement that the president signed with the Afghan government, and yet the waste, fraud, and abuse continues to go on and on. Well, that takes away from the military and their needs. I have said many times that I just do not see how this country can continue to do what is necessary to maintain a strong military unless there's some debate in the Congress about a war tax, because I don't know where the money's going to come from. If we don't level with the American people in this very unsafe world that we live in, if we want to win the war or protect Americans, then we cannot continue to go in deficit situations. And this committee is probably tired of hearing me saying it, but we are $18.1 trillion in debt. And every time I've been told that we bomb in Iraq for about an hour, it's $300 million an hour. So, I mean, at some point in time, I think the administration has got to say to Congress, we've got to pay for this war. And it's unfair for the American people not to have a Congress that is willing to do what is necessary to rebuild and strengthen our military. I'd like to know your position, your feelings, as well as General Breedlove's, because you can't do the job if you don't have the armaments. If you can't afford to buy the bombs, you can't bomb. And that's where I'm concerned, not just for these few months in front of us, but for the years to 2024, using the time in Afghanistan. Any comments?
Congressman, let me try to address some of the points you raised in sequence. First, just to clarify, because I certainly don't want to have misled the committee, our NATO allies and other partners in Afghanistan have committed to financially continue to help sustain the Afghan National Security Forces through 2024. As I think you all are very aware, President Obama has made clear that our military forces will be drawn down to a Kabul-centric footprint by the end of 2016. So I don't want to imply that we're contemplating keeping our military there through 2024. That's just an issue of providing funding to try to help the Afghan pay for the security forces they need. We are very much in contact with, for example, John Sopko, the special investigator for Afghanistan. General Campbell and he work very closely together. We take the concerns that he raises and look into them very deeply, and where there is clearly, for example, waste or fraud or abuse, we do everything we can to try to address that. I think your point about how we pay for the military we need is well taken, and I think you'll hear when Secretary Carter comes up here, I think, in the near future to talk about the overall budget request for FY16, he is going to be emphasizing that just as we come to Congress and ask you all to support our defense budget request, we have a responsibility to do everything we can to reform how the Department of Defense operates so that we are making the best use of those defense dollars. And we have been trying to do that, for example, with some of the proposals we've made to try to adjust our compensation, for example, or requesting authority for base closure. But Secretary Carter and his team, we're very aware that reforming how we do business is a key part of making sure that we're able to spend the resources that we have in an effective way.
Time of the gentleman's expired. Mr. Courtney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the witnesses. General, your opening remarks, you used the term resurgent Russia, I'd just like to explore that with you for a minute. I mean, obviously a big part of the resurgence is more investment in military spending by the Russian government. I just wonder if you could sort of walk us through what capabilities and forces have been the focus of that change.
Thank you, Congressman. And what we don't want to do is overstate. You know, that has happened in the past, that we used to talk about a 10-foot-tall Russia. But what Russia has done over the past 5 years has steeply ramped up their investment in their military, period. We see a strong commitment to their nuclear forces and upgrading their nuclear forces, making them more survivable, making the bench deeper. So a strong emphasis on their nuclear forces. And then what they have learned through the years, as you know, when they went into Georgia, it didn't go real well for them. And they learned some tough lessons. And so they have addressed those lessons in their conventional forces. And they've invested in their mobility, their readiness, they're training them to a higher level, and they're outfitting them with new equipment to make them more capable when they take the field. So it's sort of a bifurcated path, strong emphasis on nuclear weapons, and then the kind of money that you would smartly invest in order to bring up the readiness and capability of their conventional forces.
So you didn't mention naval arena, and I, you know, obviously there's been news reports about, them sort of showing up near UK and, our Scandinavian allies, and some talk about, boosting the shipyard capacity. I was wondering if you could talk about that a little bit.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry. I lumped air, land, and sea into conventional. And to make the point, they have invested in all three. They've made strong investment in their land forces, which is what you see playing out on the border of Ukraine now. They've made strong investment in their aviation capability, and they're doing the same thing with aircraft that they're doing with their naval forces. The investment in the naval forces is, again, sort of split. A good emphasis on their submarine forces and their nuclear submarine forces, as well as their conventional forces. But what we see with the more surface Navy is just bigger, better exercises training, more out of area operations, as you saw the Kuznetsov carrier go all the way into the Eastern Med and have about a 30-day rotation in the Eastern Med. Haven't seen that in a long time, so they are investing there.
And, part of the events with the Crimean takeover was that they actually, at least for some short period of time, seized a number of Ukrainian naval vessels. What's the status of that? Did they return any of those, or did they just enlarge their force by keeping them?
Several were kept. Several of the very lesser capable vessels were given back. At least one, maybe two, were scuttled in order to block the entrance and exit from the harbor in Sevastopol. The main combatant that was retained by Ukraine is their flagship, which actually was out of area on a NATO operation during the time.
And so in terms of our response and our NATO allies' response in terms of, their naval forces, can you talk about that a little bit in terms of what's happening right now?
So as a part of the assurance measures that we have done that the Undersecretary talked about, We have upped our presence in the north and in the south in our naval presence. So our standing naval group and our standing naval mine group showing a stronger presence in the Baltic seas. And then in the south, we've had not a constant presence, but almost constant presence in the Black Sea, originally in the beginning by U.S. forces, and now NATO forces are folding in with us so that we keep a NATO or U.S. presence in the Black Sea. We've done several exercises in the Black Sea with the navies, our NATO navies there, and Ukraine has participated in those exercises.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Forbes.
Chairman, thank you. And Ms. Warmoth, a few weeks ago, the chairman put together a roundtable with some of the best defense planners and strategists in the country, and they all concurred that it would be fair to categorize Mr. Putin as opportunistic. That means he would see an opportunity like Ukraine, move in there, then evaluate it based on the responses for his next movement. That the Chinese were long-term strategists, but that the United States has become more reactionary, and they felt that one of the biggest weaknesses we had now was a lack of strategy. When I listened to the chairman correctly talking about the need to perhaps give defensive legal assistance, weapons and equipment, to the Ukraine's now, Ukraine government, I'm concerned because for the longest time, this administration would not even allow our military to give information, which is kind of the baby step before you do anything else, to the people in Ukraine. We couldn't tell them about Russian troop movements, capabilities, locations, all of those kinds of things. In hindsight, was that an incorrect strategy?
Congressman, I think at the time, we made decisions about what kind of support to provide and what kind of intelligence to share based on the situation at the ground at the time. We are, for several months certainly, have been providing considerable intelligence to Ukraine.
But what was your strategy for so long not giving them that information, in fact prohibiting that information from being given?
We were giving them information we thought would be useful to them and would help them respond to
the location of where the Russian troops and the size of the troops and those kind of things would be important to the Ukraine government?
To my knowledge, Congressman, we were providing intelligence.
Can you check that and verify that for us? Yes. And please give it back to us on the record. Second thing is, talk about this resurgent Russia. Many of us were concerned when the Russians asked us to pull our missile defense systems out of Europe, and this administration said, sure, we'll do that. Two questions. In hindsight, was that a bad strategy? And secondly, where did you put the additional resources to fill that gap?
Congressman, the European phased adaptive approach that we have for missile defense in Europe is a very strong approach to deal with the missile defense threats that we face, which are primarily from the North Korea with their nuclear program, and to posture us to be able to prevent or defend against a potential future Iranian threat. We've made the investments needed to support that program.
Can you tell me where you made those investments? And if you don't have them now,
certainly,
will you supply that? Because I haven't seen where you've put those dollars. We put it on the back of the Navy, but we continue to wait for when you're going to give those additional resources to do it. Maybe you can just, if you would, just supply it for the record. And again, if you would tell us what your strategy was, whether or not a gap has been left because you have done that. And then, General, the question I would ask for you, in following up to Mr. Courtney's question about the Navy, you know, Europe used to be a hub for our Navy, and over the last decade, maybe two decades, we've allowed our naval presence to decline considerably. Based on what we see with Russia now, where do you see us going forward? Is there going to be a new level of demand, perhaps, that our Navy has? And if so, can you give us a little bit of definition of what you think that might look like?
Congressman, as you know, this is one of the places where our force structure in Europe is growing. We've received two of the Aegis destroyers that will go into Rota, and we have two more that are on schedule to come to us. They will be a multi-mission ship, but they will also be dedicated to missile defense because that's their core capability. So the U.S. presence in Europe is growing. But you rightly question that, are we taking all the right steps? And here is what I would have to say. We're making a strong push with our NATO allies to better cooperate and bring them into these assurance measures and the changes that we're making to NATO, because you are...
General, I would just point out, if we're going to do this so-called pivot to the Asia-Pacific area, and if we see this increase in Europe, then we're going to have to increase our naval presence if we're going to be able to do that. And on the ships we're talking about, we really didn't add resources to that. We just shifted ships around, which is a big difference than adding resources. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Ranking Member.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The big concern with Russia is what would they do next? I mean, obviously, we're focused on the eastern Ukraine right now, but most of the speculation is that unchecked, this leads to further problems. What would they do next? What are you guys most fearful of? Where might they try their little green men strategy next if eastern Ukraine were to be resolved in their favor?
Congressman, I think we have probably two primary areas of concern in terms of where might Russia go next. First is they might go to countries who are not part of NATO, for example, Montenegro, some of the smaller countries, and try to, again, create some instability to try to use some of the information operations techniques that we've seen them use very effectively in Ukraine. And we are working through the European Reassurance Initiative, for example, to provide support to countries like that to be able to help them to resist those kinds of activities. Similarly, we also have concerns about the potential for Russia to try to destabilize actual NATO member countries, particularly, I think, the Baltics, because, again, those countries have sizable ethnic Russian populations. So, again, we have been very, very clear, and I think Putin understands that we are completely committed to upholding our Article 5 obligations, and that to cross that line would be an extremely substantial step. But we are working in a variety of ways to try to help countries, whether inside of NATO or whether partner countries, be able to resist that kind of destabilizing activity.
And at this moment, of those possibilities, are there hints that he's moving in one direction to implement one of them? Or is it just pretty much at this point speculation? Or have there been active steps that Russia has taken that give you concern about one of those specific examples that you mentioned?
From what I've seen, we don't have, there are not significant active steps. I have not seen anything, for example, in intelligence that would indicate that, but I would ask General Breedlove to comment.
So, sir, I would just step back. I know that your question was really next after Ukraine, but I think we also need to think about next inside Ukraine, because I don't think any of us are sure that he's accomplished his objectives inside Ukraine next, and so that would be my first next. And then there might be some revisits. For instance, we start to see a more Western-leaning Moldovan government, and the Russian troops in Transnistria are there to keep Moldova from leaning to the West. And so there may be some revisit in Moldova. And I think what we should do is watch first where we see strong information campaigns picking up. And that is happening in Moldova and other places now.
Understood. And how do we change this mindset of Russia? Part of the reason for the chairman and I doing the bill that we did to give Ukraine greater position to defend themselves is to sort of up the military cost. I mean, obviously, if the Russian military decides to go full force, no matter what we do, their Ukraine is no match for them. But the higher the cost, the less likely, in my way of thinking, that he would try this in the future. And yet the administration has been a little reluctant to cross that line and do that. And I understand, we don't want to, escalate. But on the other hand, if it was more costly, if it did mean that Russia would have to, you know, commit more troops, more weaponry, lose more of their soldiers, wouldn't that be a discouragement for them to do something in Moldova or in Montenegro or any of these other places that you've talked about?
Congressman, I think that's exactly right in the sense that we are a key part of our strategy vis-a-vis Russia right now is to impose costs on them, diplomatic costs, economic costs, and then also to provide support to Ukraine. We are, as you know, I mean, the president said, I think, just before the Munich Security Conference or just after, considering all options. We don't want to take options off the table, and there is discussion of providing defensive lethal assistance in an effort to, again, raise costs on Russia, not from the perspective at all of being able to fundamentally alter the military balance between Ukraine's military and Russia's military, but to try to give Ukraine more ability to defend itself against the separatist aggression. The Minsk agreements have now been signed, and we very much want to see those upheld. Obviously, experience to date gives us, I think, pause, and actions are going to speak much more loudly than words. So as we watch whether those agreements are going to be upheld in the coming days, if we see continued violations, continued aggressions, pardon?
I see no reason to even for a second believe that they will be upheld. Isn't it rather clear at this point that Putin's strategy is to use that negotiation to neutralize Europe from, you know, fully engaging and helping, meanwhile continuing to do exactly what he wants to do? I mean, is there any counter-argument to that interpretation?
We are very concerned and I think skeptical of whether this agreement will be upheld. And if it is not, we will again look at measures to impose additional costs. So I think that conversation is still ongoing and is very active.
I think we can pretty much count on it not being upheld. So we should start planning for that. I guess that's part of the strategy. It's sort of slow rolling it, you know, keeping them at bay as he moves through the eastern Ukraine as he sees fit. So that's something we're going to have to do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. John Breedlove, good to see you. Thank you for your comments before the NATO Parliamentary Assembly and the Munich Security Conference. You have been a great voice of trying to give us clarity in this issue, in this time period of what you've described as hybrid warfare, where we see ambiguity that Russia is trying to create on their actions, which makes it more difficult for people to formulate policy and then address that policy with having clarity. So thank you for the clarity. Ms. Wormuth, I have a few questions for you, because also in your position as policy, what we don't want to have is issues of ambiguity of things that are true or not true, facts. We can disagree as to policy, but facts are those things that we shouldn't allow ourselves to degrade to ambiguity as Vladimir Putin tries to get us to do in hybrid warfare. Phase adaptive approach. You will not deny that phase four, the phase adaptive approach, was canceled, would you not?
We made a different decision, that's correct. Wouldn't deny that.
So that would be a yes. You canceled phase four of the phase adaptive approach. The phase adaptive approach was the portion of phase four that was to actually protect the continental United States. You said we have a strong commitment to the phase adaptive approach, not so strong since it's canceled, and I do want to give a footnote here, that we are all aware that the fourth phase of phase adaptive approach, which you cited as being a strong commitment, was canceled after the election, prior to with the president having had a prior conversation with Medvedev in an open mic situation where he said to him, after the election, I will have more flexibility with respect to the phase adaptive approach and what many people, including myself, refer to as the secret deal, then has the appearance of the president making a deal with Russia and subsequently canceling the phase adaptive approach, which again, underscore, would have protected the mainland of the United States. Now let's turn to START. You cited START. You would not deny, right, that the United States under START cut our deployed nuclear weapons, correct?
The New START negotiations lowered the number of nuclear weapons in our arsenal, yes.
Great. Well, you will also not deny that it did not require Russia to cut any of their deployed nuclear weapons. In fact, they had the ability to increase the number of their deployed nuclear weapons, correct?
Congressman,
just correct, right? Yes, no, it's a numbers game. These are not ambiguity issues. These are not policy for us to have a disagreement. Doesn't the numbers in START not require Russia to cut any of their nuclear deployed weapons and actually would permit them to increase them?
The New START treaty protects our interests.
Yes, no. It's yes, no. Please don't give me ambiguity. Please don't have, right where we're here in the middle of this hearing, that a question and answer where you leave people with an impression other than the truth. The truth is, under START, we cut our deployed nuclear weapons. They don't. Correct?
We cut our nuclear weapons, but not to a level to which we couldn't provide a very strong nuclear
deterrent.
Under
the numbers, under New START, they had the ability to increase, we had to cut, correct? I mean, you have to know this. Don't leave us with the impression that perhaps you don't know the circumstances.
Correct.
Correct. Thank you for giving me that correct. Now, Russia, at the time of the discussions with the with us on the New START agreement, was violating the INF treaty, correct?
Congressman, we raised Russia's violation of the INF treaty in 2013.
I'm not asking you what you raised. I'm asking you a correct or not correct. During the New START negotiations with the United States, Russia was, at that time, in violation of the INF treaty. Correct?
We had concerns that they were in violation. We know now that they were.
I'm not asking you what your concerns at the time were. We now have information. We know it clearly. So
yes, we know now that they were in violation.
Russia was violating the INF treaty at the same time that we were negotiating START. Correct?
Correct. We know that now.
Now, you started to say you had concerns, so you knew that it was that there was a possibility that they were violating the INF treaty at the time of New START.
Congressman, we had not determined that they were in violation.
You, I'm not asking we, I'm asking you.
I was not in a portfolio at that time to personally be aware, but
you have concerns of the information. Did you receive information that gave you concerns about their possible violation of the INF treaty?
At that time, we had not determined
you
that they were not compliant.
You personally had no concerns. You personally had no concerns.
At that time, I was not involved in that particular issue, Congressman.
Okay. could you please tell me why the President of the United States refuses to acknowledge that Ukraine has been invaded by Russia when they have invasion force that's on the ground? What is the term invasion that causes difficulty with the administration? I mean, Ukraine's territorial integrity has been violated. Russian troops are there. Why can't we call it an invasion?
Congressman, I think we've been more focused on what's happening as opposed to what you call it. Russia has absolutely violated Ukraine's territorial integrity and has attempted to unlawfully annex Crimea.
Mr. Chairman, why? Thank you.
Time of the gentleman's expired. Mr. O'Rourke.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Breedlove, if we arm Ukraine, what will Russia do?
Congressman, it's a great question. It's one that we are all working very hard on now. Clearly, we don't know what Mr. Putin will do. What we need to do is look at what is on the ground, the capabilities and capacities that he's building, and make inference from those capability and capacities. Right now, we are not arming the Ukrainians with lethal weapons. And what we see is Russia continues to build their force, continues to provide capability to the eastern Ukrainians. And so the fact that we're not doing now is not changing their path forward. So I think that we have to be cognizant that if we arm the Ukrainians, it could cause positive results, it could cause negative results. But what we're doing now is not changing the results on the ground.
But bottom line, I take your answer to be we do not know what Russia will do. Should we arm Ukraine? And Ms. Wormuth, would that be your answer as well?
Congressman, certainly we don't know with certainty how Russia would respond. And I also would add that in addition to thinking about whether to provide defensive lethal assistance, there are other measures we can take to try.
I understand, but the proposal on the table in terms of arming Ukraine should beg the question, what will Russia do? then what are our options when Russia does any number of different things? And what are the second, third, fourth, fifth order consequences of arming Ukraine? That's what I'm trying to get to. I understand some of those considerations probably should not be discussed here, but I think bottom line, we don't know what Russia will do. The information I have shows that we spend a little under 4% of our GDP on our armed forces. Estonia, 1.9%, Latvia, 1.0%, Lithuania, 0.8%, France, a little over 2%. Are we not, Mrs. Wormuth, creating a moral hazard for Europe, and especially for these Baltic states? What are you doing, what is the administration doing to get our NATO allies to spend a more significant percent of their budgets on military so that we are not asking our taxpayers to do their job?
That's a great question, Congressman. And we, a couple of things I would say there. First, at the Wales Summit, all of the allies agreed to a defense investment pledge to work towards providing 2% GDP as the standard. So that's an important step.
2% by when, and what are the consequences if they don't reach it?
I don't know if we put a by when on it, but what I would say is...
It's pretty urgent right now, considering everything that we just discussed.
Absolutely agree.
A date certain that you are going to commit if you want to make sure that we're going to be there for you. You've got to carry your weight. So there is not a date certain, or we just don't know what that is right now.
We think it may be 2020, Congressman, but let me check and get back to you on the specific details. Couldn't agree with you more that it is essential that our European allies invest more in defense. And this has been a longstanding challenge that we've had, frankly, with our NATO allies. Many secretaries have raised this. I do think that with everything that's happening vis-a-vis Russia right now, but also the threats posed by ISIL, our European friends have a greater appreciation for what they're truly facing, and some of them are revisiting in their own parliaments and governments how much they're investing.
So I'll just ask that you, and I appreciate that, but I'll ask that you give us a definite answer to that. You know, I certainly would like that. I think my colleagues would like to.
Certainly.
Well, my last question for General Breedlove, what lessons do you take from the 2008 Russian-Georgia war that we could apply to what we're seeing today?
So the lessons are not good ones. As I mentioned just a little earlier in one of my comments, the Russian invasion of Georgia in 2008 was accomplished, but it was not a very clean operation for them. They lost aircraft, they lost lives. It was a tough slog for them, and I don't think they expected it to be a tough slog. And what we have seen is they have been a very learning and adaptive force. They have completely cleaned up the issues that we saw in Georgia as they went into Crimea. I would love to offer you a classified briefing to show you the depth and breadth of the way they have corrected their problems. Their military issues, the way they ran the military piece into Crimea, and then just from Crimea to Donbass, or the eastern part of Ukraine, they've corrected problems there as well. So.
Thank you. I'll take you up on your offer. I yield back. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Franks.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Mr. Chairman, Mr. Turner pursued my line of questioning with Ms. Wormuth, and he did a much better job than I would have done. So if it's all right, I'm going to just suggest that some of us were very concerned about the new START because we saw it allow Russia to build up a stockpile of strategic weapons and for us to be required to build down. And it did not take into consideration the tactical capability of Russia, especially in Europe. And in retrospect, it appears to me that this Russia reset has been a startling failure. That's a sincere conclusion. And I know it doesn't really probably track with your own perspective. So I'm going to, if I could, switch over to General Breedlove here. And General, you know, every time you come here, I try to say something nice about you because I think you people like you that stand out there and give your whole lives for the cause of freedom are the noblest among us. And I'm just wondering how he keeps carrying those stars they keep putting on him here. It's starting to be a pretty good thing for such an old guy, you know. But I say that having been in an F-16 with him during a 360-degree loop, so I've had a lot of confidence in him at that time. But the EPAA phase II was set fully to be implemented this year. Can you just discuss the need for increased missile defense capability in your AOR?
Congressman, thank you for that. EPAA Phase II is on track for delivery capability in 16 to be ready. We see all of the actions on the ground doing well. The budget is going well. We may be a month or so behind in the construction, but we think we're ready to deliver on time for that. We see the authorities and everything that we need shaping up there. And we also see that the progress on starting the next phase in Poland is tracking as well.
Well, let me ask you, the department has requested a multi-year procurement authority for the SM-31B, and that hopefully would achieve critical cost savings and production stability. Can you speak to that request and its significance or importance?
Congressman, my facts agree with yours that the proposed way to go forward on purchasing these missiles now will save us. I think the number is 14% across the first buy, and that's significant. And it also addresses some of the long lead term items, issues that the company would be working in to deliver those missiles. More importantly, to me, is that the capability inherent in that SM-31B is important to the mission that we need to do in both of these sites, the site in Romania and the site in Poland. And so we hope to stay on track with delivery of the capabilities that missile brings.
Well, I want to just ask two last questions, and they're a little bit eclectic, and just give you the time to elaborate as you will. Given your area of expertise with the whole situation happening in Crimea and Ukraine, first question is, what would you suggest would be the most important policy or strategic initiative we should pursue to contain that problem the best that we can, given the circumstances? And then number two, completely different subject, related to the danger of ISIS and Islamist terrorism in the world, what do you consider as a general to be the most significant, at least strategic approach that we might have? I know tactically we've engaged them very effectively, but strategically, what do you think is the most important thing that we're missing here? And how significant do you think the failure to approach to address that is?
If you allow me, I will lightly remark to the policy and strategy piece, and I might ask the Secretary to remark to that. Let me start with ISIS, because I don't want to run your time out. As we understand the problem of ISIS, one of the main things that I think we need to focus on is their legitimacy. This caliphate draws to it those who would want to come and fight for the caliphate. And the incredible information campaign that they have out there and other things that just transmits the legitimacy of this caliphate. We need to attack it. We understand, and I won't go into it here to take all your time, those elements that make the caliphate real to those who would follow it, and I think we attack them in detail.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Ms. Davis.
Thank you, Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both for being here, for your service. No, we've had a discussion about, I guess, the question, what would Russia do? And I wanted to just be certain and clarify. There are obviously proposals about providing more than non-lethal support to Ukraine, and that does trigger our thinking about their using conventional, perhaps even tactical weapons at some point. What can you tell us some more about, how that calculation is and sort of the response of the Congress and what you'd like to see?
Congresswoman, in terms, again, we don't know with certainty what Russia would do if we were to provide defensive lethal assistance. I think what needs to be weighed is, again, providing that those kinds of systems, for example, might well strengthen Ukraine's ability to defend itself, be more effective against Russian tanks, for example. But the potential concern that has to be weighed is, does Russia then double down and provide even more heavy equipment and just escalate the violence cause more human suffering and continue to sort of prosecute its campaign. So part of, I think, what we have to look at is whether there are other tools that might also impose costs on Russia and cause Russia to pause and reevaluate where it's going. And do the pros and cons of those other tools, for example, such as economic sanctions or other steps that could be taken in the financial domain, would they potentially be more effective and have fewer downsides? So I think those are some of the issues that we need to be weighing as
I'm asking, too, about how the discussions here in the Congress are read in terms of what we would anticipate or what we would like to see. And I don't know, General, if you want to weigh in on that.
Ma'am, first I would echo what the Secretary has said, and that is that I think that the discussion of defensive lethal aid is very important. It's one of the tools. We talk about dime, diplomatic, informational, military, and economic. And I think that these need to be worked at the same time. Mr. Putin is putting intense diplomatic pressure on Kyiv. The information campaign is quite impressive. And the disinformation campaign is quite impressive. Clearly, Mr. Putin is all in when it comes to the military element. And then he is attempting to put economic pressure through energy and recalling loans early, et cetera, on Ukraine. And so I think that the discussion about the military element is incredibly important. But we also have to continue to bring the pressure on all fronts across these four areas.
Okay, thank you. We've talked about the our allies providing more defensive support. And just going back to your numbers, General, about the military personnel at UCOM, you mentioned 65,000 is a, how much, does that include allied personnel?
No, Congresswoman, that's our U.S. Personnel in European command.
And so allied personnel is where in that?
That's more, we talk about that more in terms of the NATO alliance and what they bring to that alliance. And clearly the depth and breadth of all of the nations of NATO's and their militaries is quite significant. But the readiness and capability are the things that we are working on together to raise that capability in our NATO alliance. Mm-hmm.
So the fact that you're working on that in terms of readiness doesn't necessarily mean that they're ready to deploy alongside U.S. troops at this time?
Ma'am, I would say that they have some of the same problems that we have in our military. They have forces that are capable and ready right now, and others that are a more increased responsiveness.
Is there a number that you would be more comfortable with when you think about adequately staffing UCOM for our current global missions?
Ma'am, I'd like to come back to you on that. I didn't come prepared to talk about growing my command. We're just working on the mission that we have, but I'd love to come back and talk to you about that.
I was going to turn really quickly to Afghanistan as well, because Secretary Carter is now talking about slowing the withdrawal. Do we have the support, again, with our partners in being able to do that? And we can take that later for the record. Thank you.
Thank you. Occurs to me that nobody can know for certain how Putin would respond to us providing weapons. What we can know for certain is how he's responded without us providing weapons, and that hadn't gone very well. Mr. Whitman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Wormuth, General Breedlove, thank you for joining us. I want to ask, so far the administration's strategy to counter Russian aggression is focused on sanctions. We've heard senior Russian officials, though, say that Russians will eat less food and use less electricity. Just this past Saturday, Secretary Kerry said the administration is exploring additional sanctions on Russia. Give me your perspective. How effective to this point have sanctions been? Will they be more effective in the future in changing the Russian calculus? And what military options have you suggested to the administration to counter Russian aggression in Ukraine?
Congressman, on the sanctions and their effectiveness, the sanctions that we and the Europeans have put in place on Russia are having a very significant effect on their economy, and those effects are growing over time. But I think we would all agree that it hasn't changed what Russia's been doing on the ground.
Give some specifics about what those effects are. I mean, that's a general terminology. They're mm-hmm. affecting their economy. Tell me, how's it affecting the economy? The lives, the daily lives of Russians. Is it really hurting them? Give us some perspective on what that is.
I will try to do that. The value of the ruble, for example, has fallen substantially. They have very large strategic financial reserves, but they are having to draw those down to be able to provide fluidity in their economy. So the size of those financial reserves are shrinking substantially and will continue to do that. And I think we will see that effect happen over time and sort of have a cumulative effect. But again, I think we would agree that despite the significant economic costs that are starting to have effects on the Russian population and on the oligarchs, we're hearing, for example, more dissatisfaction of the oligarchs who to date have been very supportive of Putin. They are concerned about the impact it's having on their businesses, on their own financial holdings. But it has not changed so far what Russia has been doing on the ground, and that is the great concern we have, and that is where there's a need to, again, look at the overall package of cost-imposing strategies towards Russia and also support to Ukraine to see if we can change the calculus going forward.
Very good. General Breedlove?
Congressman, on the military options to date, I'll talk just briefly to U.S. and to our allies. Both U.S. and allies have brought primarily non-lethal aid to the table to help the Ukrainian military, and these are well-known, everything from medical capabilities, food, to probably on the high end our counter-mortar radars that we've delivered to them, which are defensive in nature, to allow the Ukrainians to understand when they're under attack, et cetera. The change now is that while we are considering and are deliberating possibilities of lethal aid, now nations are beginning to also do what for nations outside of the U.S. is categorized as training. You've recently heard both Canada and U.K. announce that they're going in to do training in various things. In the United States, we have a deep relationship with the Ukrainians that was already underway before this all started. And we are doing coaching and mentoring. You probably have heard and seen reported in the paper today that we have a team going in to do medical coaching and mentoring now. So we have non-lethal aid, nations doing training, U.S. forces doing coaching and mentoring, and then, of course, our nation is deliberating the next step.
Very good. General Breedlove, let me ask you this from your perspective. Do you believe that Vladimir Putin's strategy is to undermine the credibility of NATO as it relates to its Article 5 obligation to protect NATO nations? And if so, do you believe that his next move might be to Latvia, Estonia, and Lithuania in trying to destabilize that region?
Congressman, I think that the main goal of Mr. Putin is to divide the West in general. In EU terms economically, as you see him try to build his own economic union, and also militarily to divide NATO, to try to find those cracks, live in them, expand them, and try to bring dissent to the conversation. So I absolutely believe that is his number one goal. If he divides NATO, he gets Ukraine. It would happen. As to Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, I'm not sure that would be the next targets. He understands what Article 5 means.
Mr. Moulton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Breedlove, I'm interested in whether you think that we have essentially exhausted our means of supporting Ukraine with non-lethal aid at this point, and whether that, therefore, lethal aid is the next logical step.
Congressman, no, I don't think we've exhausted the options in non-lethal aid, but I don't think that's directly tied to should lethal be the next step.
I agree.
There's much more that we can continue to do, but that doesn't preclude then should we also consider lethal.
No, I agree with that point. I'm just curious of whether we've exhausted those options. I'm also interested in what, both from the OSD perspective and from your perspective, would be other avenues of escalation. And I understand that some of this may be classified, but if you can speak to that for a minute, I'd appreciate it.
So, Congressman, thank you for that. There are other, as we just talked about a few minutes ago, we are focused on the military piece of the four pieces of four types of power that a nation has, but diplomatic efforts can continue, and we can step those up. Informational work, we are frankly well behind the Russians in this area. Their disinformation campaign is very impressive. And then, as you know, the debate about will there be further economic tools used, that is continues to be talked about. So I completely agree that we need to go back at Russia across all four elements of national power.
Great. Ms. Warmoth, do you have anything to add to that?
No, I think that's a very good elucidation of what we're trying to do.
Okay, great. Mm-hmm. Could you just take a minute to comment for a second on your view as to whether a new start was in our national security interests or not?
Certainly, Congressman, thank you. The New START Treaty was in our interests. We were able to negotiate with the Russians and come to an agreement as to the size of both arsenals. We would not, I mean, fundamentally, the only reason to pursue negotiated arms control treaties is to do it if it's in the interests of the United States, from our perspective, for example. So our view was very much that through New START, in addition to looking at the overall size of the strategic arsenal, it gave us a verification regime. It allowed us to go in and have transparency to the Russian arsenal, to have predictability in terms of understanding what they're doing with that part of their nuclear arsenal. And all of that adds to strategic stability. So I think the administration's view is very much that the New START Treaty was in our interest.
Right, but could you just explain that a bit more? Because Mr. Turner raised the question that if the overall number of Russian weapons goes up and ours stays the same or goes down, it doesn't seem to the sort of casual observer that that would be a favorable agreement for us.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, in terms of the overall levels of our arsenal versus the Russian arsenal, there are, you know, we do not have exact strategic parity in terms of down to the very last number. But what we negotiated through New START was a level for both sides that provided for basically the fundamental soundness of our strategic deterrent. So, you know, and it is fair to say that the tactical nuclear weapons that Russia had were outside of that agreement, but from a strategic nuclear force perspective, the levels that we have are ones that very much allow us to provide the kind of nuclear deterrent that we need to have.
Given that, Mr. Putin's new ambitions in Europe, would you say that that leaving tactical nuclear weapons out of that agreement is of greater concern now?
Congressman, I don't think it's of greater concern necessarily. I mean, it would be desirable, certainly, to convince Russia to be able to reduce its overall amount of tactical nuclear weapons. They have a very large number. But a country has to be willing to do that. That disparity existed before the situation we have now. I don't think there's a need to be more concerned about it before. I mean, again, I think fundamentally we have to make sure that we have the full range of military capabilities to deter Russia effectively, and we do that through a combination of our conventional force posture and our nuclear force posture.
I think 10 years ago we didn't expect this kind of movement on behalf of Russia.
That's certainly true.
Do you think that we should consider expanding our tactical nuclear arms?
I think the nuclear deterrent we have today very much protects our national security interests.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Important questions we will dig deeper into in the future. Mr. Gibson.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate the panelists being here today. First, a question about Lieutenant Nadia Savchenko. Interested in what we know about her current health and about release.
Congressman, we don't know as much as we would like to know. What we do hear is that she is well cared for. It's not a, it is not an arduous affair, but that is clearly what we are being told. We have no indications one way or the other. And this is a strong point of the constant contact as Ukraine negotiates forward.
I'm following that situation very closely and appreciate your attention to that as well. Question now is really more one of a whole of government. So, Ms. Warmoth, I'm interested in your insights with regard to your actions in the interagency, and specifically here I'm asking about the status of political military cohesion and unity within Ukraine and across Ukraine, and the status of civil military relations inside Ukraine, because really the focus, the thrust of the question is, how are we doing as far as helping Ukraine strengthen itself?
Thank you, Congressman, for that question. I think we're working very hard across a range of fronts to try to help Ukraine strengthen itself, and I think that the dime construct is a good way to try and talk about that. So, you know, for example, the State Department is engaging at all levels, from Secretary Kerry and President Poroshenko down to the level of our ambassador. And we are very much, you know, working with them and talking with them about their political situation. In terms of, you know, as I've said earlier, we have significantly increased our security assistance to the Ukrainian military. And as General Breedlove mentioned, we are providing training. We have something called the Joint Commission with Ukraine's military that we've used to talk with them about what their requirements are, both in the near term, but also over the long term as they try to professionalize their military. On the economic front, we are working to through the IMF to try to secure additional economic assistance, because obviously Ukraine has a very difficult economic situation as well. So I think across all fronts, we are doing a lot to try to help Ukraine strengthen itself and be better able to determine its own path as a sovereign country.
So then, more specifically, what I'm concerned about is certainly the reports that I read, and from my constituents, I have a strong Ukrainian-American communities in upstate New York, Kherson, other places, and so I often hear of, at times, different approaches in different parts of Ukraine. So now I have a geographic question. And how are we interacting that maybe helps strengthen and unifying some of the geographic differences of opinion as it relates to political military? And then, of course, that question is still on the table. Do you have any concerns on the civil-military relations inside Ukraine?
Congressman, I don't have significant concerns about the civil-military situation in Ukraine. I would certainly ask General Breedlove if he wants to elaborate on that. But I saw our ambassador to Ukraine when I was in Munich just a few weeks ago, and the report I had from him was that those relationships are pretty strong. I was also struck in talking with him about his sense that when you drive throughout all different parts of Ukraine, if anything, the Russian aggression in most areas has strengthened Ukrainian nationalism. And which, you know, again, I think gives the lie to the whole idea that somehow this is an indigenous movement that's coming out of Ukraine and that there are individuals who feel that their, you know, rights are at risk. I think, you know, he talked about how roads, farmland, fences were painted blue and yellow, again, as an expression of their strong nationalism.
I'll just jump on that a little bit, and that was a vignette I was going to use. Post-Crimea, prior to Donbass, this nationalism was very, very high. I think that you would find east of the Dnieper River that it's probably a little strained now because of what they've seen. I don't think we have targeted any geographic unity, but what we do know is that Mr. Putin is trying to drive a wedge in the government, and we're trying to help them to fight that.
That's an encouraging report, and I'll continue to watch very closely. Mr. Chairman, thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Larson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My quick assessment is that for Russia on the economic front, they care about what's going on and they can care more. Diplomatically, they don't care what people think. And militarily, the West has to find a way to get them to care more. And right now we're not. Because backing diplomacy with nothing is going to continue to get us, you know, we'll have Minx 3 and Minx 4 and Minx 5 and still no action out of Russia, in my view. So, General, I want to ask you a question that was asked of you or somebody at the NATO PA, and it's simple. I mean, do you think Russia understands the difference between a NATO country and a non-NATO country?
Congressman, the short answer is yes. I believe they do understand what Article 5 means, and I think they do respect that. But that does not mean that they will not reach out to those dense Russian-speaking populations that might be in a couple of our border NATO nations to see if there is a way to raise and foment unrest there.
Thanks. And do you think would a lack of quick NATO consensus on a specific action to counter an Article 5 violation would preclude any one NATO ally from acting to defend Article 5?
Congressman, I would just say that I was at Wales, and I've been at every meeting since Wales. And one of the things that was most striking to me is that while we have lots of tough conversations, as you know, NATO is not only facing Russia to the north and east, but there is a growing concern about the south, what is coming across the Med from Africa, what's coming out of the Levant and Syria and Iraq. So there's lots of things that sort of cause us to have conversations about where we should focus. But what I was struck by in every meeting since Wales is the ironclad commitment to Article 5 responsibilities and defense.
Ms. Warmoth, what do you think has been the primary objective of Russia's military modernization?
I think, Congressman, the primary objective of Russia's military modernization is to demonstrate its vision of itself, which is to be a global power on the world stage. And you know, in the wake of the Cold War, Russia's military declined to a significant degree, and Putin has very methodically, as General Breedlove outlined, gone about rebuilding in many ways the conventional and nuclear sides of the Russian force. And I think Putin sees that strong military as an important tool in his ability to function in his own mind as a global power and to be able to protect what he sees as Russia's rightful sphere of influence.
Well, General, talk a little bit about that rightful sphere of influence, because in your testimony, although you didn't cover it in your oral and your written, you discussed the Russian investment in infrastructure in the Arctic. And the United States actually chairs the Arctic Council starting in April of this year. And Commandant Papp, former Commandant of the Coast Guard, is the State Department's designated that. Russia's a member of the Arctic Council. I don't imagine that's going to get in the way of the Arctic Council doing whatever it needs to do, but there is this issue of the Arctic opening up, more water days per year, and then you have this heavy investment, it seems, from Russia in the Arctic. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Congressman, just to agree with much of what you said, that there is this opening and changing way that we might be able to use the Arctic. And frankly, one would hope that we could see that as an opportunity in a place that we might cooperate. But there are concerns by the NATO nations who are along the Arctic, or all of the eight nations of the Arctic really are watching what's going on up there, and some have more concern than others. Clearly, as you state, the Russians are changing the nature and capabilities of their infrastructure in the Arctic. This could either be for good or not.
Yeah. You know what? I've got a question, but I don't want to get tapped down by the chairman, so I'll yield back.
I appreciate the gentleman's consideration. With the largest committee in the Congress, we've got to stay on time. Gotcha. Mr. Scott.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ma'am, General Breedlove, General, thank you for joining me at Robins Air Force Base a couple of weeks ago. We have picked up all of the Georgia Tech stickers and tags that we handed out prior to your arrival, but should you choose to come back, we'll be more than willing to hand them out again. And I hope you will. I hope you'll join us at Robins or at Moody, but I know you're busy. And I want to talk about one of the platforms that flies out of Robins Air Force Base right now, if I can, and that's the JSTARS. We've worked to recapitalize that program over the last several years. The Air Force has asked for that, certainly want to continue that. The new budget submission provides funding to keep the five additional EHCs that were scheduled for divestment to recapitalize the fleet. And just like to hear the battle management, command and control capabilities of that system, how they have benefited in the current fights that we're in, that you were directly in control of in that capability. And then, again, making sure that understanding the needs of that platform, we're going to continue with the recapitalization of it to get that ISR platform that not only us but our allies need in these fights.
Congressman, thanks for that, and I'll refrain from the Georgia Tech discussion. The clearly, the capabilities of this aircraft are key and essential to everything that we do. The ability not only to have some command and control capability aloft, but the other part of the mission and looking at the ground, et cetera, et cetera. So we are, as I would say, that every COCOM that sits here in front of you would tell you that these are capabilities we need into the future to be able to do not only our ISR business, but our command and control.
Do you consider it urgent? Would that be an appropriate word to use with regard to?
I think that the demonstration of how fiercely we compete to have that capability in our theater points to how needed it is. It is a requirement we need.
Well, I look forward to working with you to expand that capability, and thank you for your support of Robins. Ma'am, I want to talk about our NATO allies for a second. One of my primary concerns as a husband and a father is that when I look at our overall budget picture, within 5 years, the net interest on our national debt will exceed what we spend on national security. And I look at what our NATO partners are committed to contribute towards what I would consider global security, and I look at what they are contributing, and they're not living up to their end of the bargain, if you will. What do we need to do differently to explain to them that while we as the United States want to be a good partner, we're perfectly willing to take the lead, we're perfectly willing to, on a dollar share, put more in because our economy is stronger, but we can't carry all of the weight? How do we get our NATO partners to put in what they committed to put in?
Congressman, that's a great question. And I share your concern. I share your concern as a taxpayer and as a parent. I have two daughters and was trying to explain to them last night what sequestration is. So it's a very good question to ask, what do we need to do differently, or what more can we do? Because this conversation about defense investment with our NATO allies has been a long-standing conversation. And I think what we can do is take steps like we did at the Wales Summit, where we got NATO allies to sign up to a defense investment pledge. The hard work, though, is going to be going forward, making sure that they do live up to that. But what we can do and what we are doing is both raising it at the highest levels. This is something that when Secretary Hagel met with the German MOD a few months ago, he raised it with her. Secretary Carter will be raising this with his counterparts. But we also can be having very serious conversations, I think, with the Europeans about the very real and serious security threats that they are facing, and how to be able to have the capabilities they need to be able to be interoperable with us they simply have to make those investments. And part of the defense investment pledge was to say that 20% of their defense budget should go to investment in major equipment systems and more R&D.
I'm out of time. If I could finish with one statement, Mr. Chairman, if you would indulge me, we can push whoever we need to out of a territory. We as the United States with our allies. But at some point, somebody's got to hold that territory. It's a big world. We can't hold it all. And if our NATO allies aren't putting in their share so that they can hold their own territory, and I recognize the Ukraine's not NATO with us, but they have to be able to hold their own territory. We can't hold every country for them.
Ms. Gabbard.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Breedlove, I'm wondering if you can talk to the unconventional tactics being used by Russia, specifically what is being done to counter those. You know, when we look at Ukraine, everyone is obviously recognizes that there's no head-to-head or tank-to-tank battle that's possible between Ukraine and Russia. So I'm wondering what's being done, whether it's done by the U.S. or done by other countries to assist Ukraine. We've talked about lethal assistance, but also with regards to training assistance for them to counter these unconventional tactics with unconventional tactics and to begin to exact a toll on the Russian military that becomes more evident to the Russian people beyond the toll that's there from the sanctions.
Congressman, thanks. And if I could just open the question a little bit, too. We talk a lot about the unconventional tactics in the military side, but I think we have to remember that they are being unconventional in diplomatic, incredibly unconventional in the information sphere, and then they are using those sort of tough tools in the economics as well. So the D, the I, and the E of dime are all in unconventional operations for the Russians. And so we need to help our partners to be able to work that. Broadly then, in the military piece, there's three things we're helping all of our nations, and this is work we're doing in the Baltics right now, even more so than in Ukraine, to preclude this problem in the future. And that is to give our nations the ability to understand it's more than military, it's normally almost more a Ministry of Interior problem, to develop the capabilities to do three things. Recognize that we have unconventional warfare going on, characterize it as unconventional as opposed to just normal issues, political issues in the populace, and then attribute it to an aggressor nation if it's being imposed. So recognize, characterize and attribute. And then when we can do that, we can have other nations to be more involved in how we fight that battle. So we are developing right now capabilities inside these nations to take those steps and get their laws and authorities right inside their own nations to be able to attack this when it occurs to them.
Okay, I have another question with regard to the EU, but I think that's an issue that I and others on the committee would like to hear more about, specifically because Ukraine is where things are happening, and then also how the other Baltic states and NATO allies are also preparing. With regards to the traffic of foreign fighters and the flow between Syria and through Turkey, what is the EU doing, and what role are you playing in working with them to address that issue and the fact that they're ability to, or their willingness to cross-reference names on terror watch lists, for example, and to track people who are coming through those porous borders and between these EU nations, how is that being addressed and improved given these weaknesses have been identified?
Do you want me to take
that? Sure. Oh, I can. Yeah. Congresswoman, that's a great question. One of the major lines of effort in our counter-ISIL strategy is trying to address the foreign fighter network problem. There are, I think at the last that I read, as many as 20,000 foreign fighters flowing from more than 90 countries into Iraq and Syria. So it's an extremely significant challenge. We are working with the countries in the European Union to try to help them, I mean, much as combating some of these unconventional tactics, to try to help them strengthen their laws that govern their border security, that govern their travel regulations. We are working with them to try to help them strengthen their intelligence organization's ability to identify these networks and to identify where the facilitators are. There's more work to be done, but this is a major prong in our strategy. It has to be a truly international effort, because if you only address it in a particular region or within the context of Europe, you know, the water balloon.
But wouldn't you say a majority of those numbers that you threw out are, though, within that region at this juncture?
Many of them are coming from European countries. Right. That is certainly true. We also see them coming from places like Indonesia and elsewhere in Asia.
But since we're talking about this region right now, is Turkey on board?
Turkey has been steadily improving. There is more work to be done, though. Turkey is one of the transit points that we are most concerned about. They are getting better. They have put more people on their watch list. But there's more work to be done with Turkey.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Bridenstine.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Breedlove, I think there's a lot of people that don't understand the important relationship between U.S. European Command and the Nation of Israel. Could you brief us on some of our commitments to Israel, maybe some of our mill-to-mill exercises, that kind of thing? How important is what you do to the Nation of Israel?
So, Congressman, thank you. Some I can discuss here. Others I would be glad to come talk to you in a classified environment. U.S. European Command has been given the mission of assisting in the defense of Israel. Probably the most visible piece of that is our joint work in ballistic missile defense and how we would help Israel to do that. And because of their, as you know, strategic depth is not something that Israel has. And so being able to help them defend that. And we have a series of exercises that are some of the best that we do in this ballistic missile business. We have great exercises in the air defense, Air Force across the board. I think at that point I would defer to a more classified conversation.
Well, I appreciate that. And another question I had is, and maybe this is for you, Ms. Wormuth, if we were to go continue through the sequestration process, maybe you could help us understand a little bit about how that would impact the Nation of Israel and European Command, and maybe General Breedlove, you could highlight as well, too, because we're about to go through a budget process here in the U.S. Congress, and I, for one, believe we need to get beyond sequestration, especially as it relates to our defense forces, and we hear all the time about the increased risk. Can you guys quantify that for us?
Thank you, Congressman. Let me try to answer your question there. I think if we return to sequestration levels of funding, it will have a profound impact, a profound negative impact, I would argue, on what we're trying to do in European Command and that in the Europe AOR, but also globally. You know, at the current level of funding that the President has requested, we're able to execute our strategy at a manageable risk level, I would argue, but we are already now at the point where we don't really have a margin. You know, I think you've heard General Breedlove say, for example, he is showing American presence through a rotational approach as opposed to permanent presence in some cases. And under sequestration, we would be forced to look at choices between the size of our Army, our Air Force. We would be, just as we did in 2013, we would be having to eliminate exercises with countries in Europe, for example, potentially Israel. We would be facing some very difficult choices. And in terms of speaking to the risk in a little bit more concrete way, you know, the way I think about it is part of what we do is to try to prevent crises from arising, and we do that through our forward presence. We do that through our engagement. If under sequestration, we will have a smaller military that will make it difficult for us to maintain that presence. We will have a military that will be less ready and less able to respond to crises. If we were to get in a major conflict, that conflict would extend far longer than we want it to be. It would be higher casualties. So there are very substantial real-world implications to that kind of risk.
And General, I can tell you, you'd like to answer this as well, but I'd like to move on to one last question with my one remaining minute. We know that Iran is continuing with an ICBM program. We know that Hamas and Hezbollah are reconstituting their missile capabilities. ISIS, of course, is in the region. My question is this: What did the administration go through as far as a process to determine in its budget request that it was appropriate to cut $150 million from missile defense for Israel?
Congressman, I don't have the figures at my fingertips in terms of what level of cuts we've made. As General Breedlove indicated, we are supporting Israel very robustly through programs like Iron Dome, David Sling, the Arrow program.
With my 23 seconds, Arrow was cut, I think, $45 million. David Sling was cut $100 million from appropriated levels last year. Any comment on that?
Well, we're making very difficult choices. You know, since 2012, we have absorbed almost $1 trillion in reductions to planned defense spending over a 10-year period. And in that context, we're having to make difficult choices already.
Mr. Rogers.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all for being here. General Breedlove, in your opinion, has Russia achieved an operational capability of its INF treaty-violating ground launched cruise missile?
Congressman, I'd really like to talk to you about that in a classified environment, and I will get on your calendar to do that.
I'd appreciate that. Well, let me ask this. Do you agree with Chairman Dempsey that Russia's INF systems pose a threat to our deployed forces in Europe?
Yes, sir, I do.
And what is your best military advice about the response most likely to assure our allies and to prevent Russia from obtaining military advantage from these actions?
So, Congressman, there is a series of things that we can do, and some of those were discussed by some of our senior leaders in the past days. We need to first and foremost signal that we cannot accept this change, and that if this change is continued, that we will have to change the cost calculus for Russia in order to help them to find their way to a less bellicose position.
A little while ago, one of my predecessors on the dais up here asked you about what would Russia do next, in your opinion, if it continues unopposed across Ukraine. And they specifically ask if you thought that the Baltics, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, would be the next target, and you stated that you felt that Vladimir Putin fully understood Article 5. So what is your professional opinion as to what might be the next concern that we would have in that region?
So, Congressman, it is a tough question, and there are several options available. As I mentioned before, I think first and foremost, Mr. Putin has not accomplished his objectives yet in Ukraine, so next is probably more action in Ukraine. We do see the seeds of issues in Transnistria and eastern Moldova. We do see, as you know, continued pressure being put on Georgia and Abkhazia. So there are several places where pressure is being brought on these nations to keep them from leaning west, and so there are options there. I do, as I have said already today, believe that Mr. Putin understands Article 5, but I do not believe that that would preclude Mr. Putin from taking some actions in reaching out to the disparate Russian-speaking populations that are in some of our easternmost nations in NATO.
Is it your opinion that if we don't, and I'm asking your opinion, I don't want to be leading in this question, but if lethal aid is not provided by the United States, is your best military opinion that the Ukrainian military can, in fact, stop the progress of the Russian troops across their country, or can they not?
Congressman, in the current configuration, I do not think that the Ukrainian forces can stop a Russian advance in eastern Ukraine. And to the degree that we can supply help, I'm not sure that they could stop a Russian advance in eastern Ukraine, even if we supply aid. I think that
lethal aid.
Lethal aid. That's correct. Congressman, I think that what we're talking about is changing the calculus of the decisions that Mr. Putin has to make and the cost to him in his internal environment more than the external environment.
You're talking body bags.
It's all right. I think we should talk about raising the cost for Russia in many dimensions. Yes, sir.
Ms. Warmer, thank you, General. In reading your opening statement, I was concerned that you made no reference at all to INF treaty violations by Russia, given that Secretary Carter, right out of the gate, has made it clear this is a big problem that we're facing, and he takes it seriously. Why did you not think it was worthy of mention in your opening statement?
Congressman, that was an, excuse me, I don't want to be yelling at you. The fact that it wasn't mentioned in my written statement was not an indication that we're not deeply concerned about it. They are in violation. It is a problem. We have been raising this with them since 2013, making clear that their violation is unacceptable. And we are quite concerned about it. As General Breedlove said, we want to continue to try to bring them back into compliance. But if they do not do that, we do not want them to have a military advantage over us. And we'll look at what responses are appropriate to take.
Great. Thank you.
Ms. McSally.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks for your testimony today. General Breedlove, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about truth and disclosure. I was part of the team to stand up Africa Command. Back in 2007 to 2010. And you mentioned the 65,000 assigned to you. That includes forces that are dual-hatted, components to Africa Command, and also forces assigned to you as a staff officer. Great frustration that, you know, we did not have the forces required to include crisis response forces. So I haven't been there in a while, so just wanted to get your perspective on, especially with the increasing activity in your theater and responsibilities, how is that working? And do you see if there's a crisis where you need a crisis response team in your theater, but we also have a Benghazi-like situation in Africa Command, how does that work? Have you seen any shortfalls where you haven't been able to fill missions? And also, as we're looking for places to gain savings, I've heard some of my colleagues talk about how Africa Command can just roll back into EUCOM again. And having been a part of that, with all you have on your plate, adding another 53 countries in Africa and the ungoverned spaces and the terrorism threat and everything we're doing there, I strongly disagree with that. So I wanted to hear your perspectives on that proposal as we move forward. Thanks.
So there's been some very good news since you left in that, as you may or may not heard, we have been given the authority at the combatant commander and deputy combatant commander level between EUCOM and AFRICOM to move forces back and forth without going through the DEPORD book process in the Pentagon. So
you have two crises at once, something's got to get a priority, right?
There's no doubt about that, and that priority would probably be adjudicated. But what happens is that Rod Rodriguez and I can make these decisions now very quickly and move the forces back and forth. And you had it right. Almost all the force is in EUCOM. There are some small crisis response MAGTAF forces in AFRICOM, but we are free to share at a very quick and easy way. I completely agree with you about Africa Command and EUCOM, but for a different reason. In Africa, the growing mission, the growing problem with radicals and with terrorists and ungoverned spaces in these nations, the focus that AFRICOM is able to bring on that is unique to the fact that there is a combatant commander assigned to focus on that. And I don't think that where the next problem really is going to be would be the place that we would want to lose focus.
Thank you. No, I do agree for the same reasons. Next question is, we closed down the squadron of A-10s at Spangdahlem a couple years ago, and the squadron that I commanded at Davis-Monthan just deployed over to Spangdahlem. You can't make this stuff up. So we're in a situation where we're closing down A-10s in Europe, and then we're deploying A-10s from CONUS to Europe. Can we walk through kind of the logic behind that and the cost? Maybe you don't have that, but maybe for the record later, the cost of deploying units forward versus having kept them there in the first place. And are you seeing value with that deployment? And you certainly can't have the squadron from Davis-Monthan full-time, but in a future discussion, hindsight, should we have just kept a squadron of A-10s at Spang?
I would defer to the Undersecretary for some of the policy piece of that. I would like to say that it is clear that the capabilities that these aircraft bring is needed. You already know, I think, in the military, as a combatant commander, we try not to prescribe the tool. We ask for a capability, and in an anti-armor capability, certainly the A-10s bring a great capability forward to Spang. I have often said that I favor forward stationed forces. When the budget changes and precludes and forces are cut or brought down, then it's important that we have the ability to bring rotational forces. Rotational forces are only good if they have solid fiscal backing in order to be able to employ.
Congresswoman, I would just again go back to the figure I cited before, where we've absorbed just a very, very large set of reductions from what we planned just a few years ago. And as General Welsh has testified, the A-10 is a great platform. And all other things being equal, we'd like to keep that. But in order to modernize the Air Force, which is in desperate need of recapitalization, we've had to make some tough choices. And yep. I think that's what you're seeing.
And my time's expired, but I'd just say I'd like a cost analysis of keeping a squadron at Spang versus the cost of sending them TDY, which potentially could be more costly in the long run. So if we're gaining savings, let's make sure we're actually gaining savings. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Nugent.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, General Breedlove and Ms. Warmoth, for being here. And just to follow up on the A-10 issue, and we all know that it's more than just armor that it can devastate. Having sons that actually saw the use of A-10s on unconventional forces and the fear factor that placed upon them was huge. So I would just, once again, I happen to like the A-10s because my kids, who called upon them to protect them when danger was close, was phenomenal. But getting past that, and we've talked about Russia, I think, and a lot of this needs to be in a classified setting, I agree. But when you talk about ISIS, and particularly forget about ISIS, but talk about the Islamic extremism that is rampant across this world, I start to worry that, we try to isolate, we got European Command, what goes on within Europe, and then we have, Africa Command, which is under-resourced, obviously. One of my sons actually did a tour down Africa training up Ghanaian soldiers. But when you look at the threat, and we had King Abdullah here, that really gave us, I think, a very enlightened aspect in regards to, the fight is within Islam itself. And until I think we identify the fact that that's where the fight is, that is problematic on strategy. But he was saying, and I tend to agree, is that it needs to be a coordinated attack across the broad spectrum. And I don't know that we have the ability to have a coordinated fight brought to the Islamic extremists when you have them parceled out by Africa Command, European Command, and what goes on in PACOM. Is there a way to coordinate all of that? Because I worry that we're not, and he was talking about that coordinated approach in particular.
I'll allow the Secretary to talk to the larger part of the question, but let me assure you that we are not doing disparate attacks. I just literally came from Kuwait, where all of the leaders, to include our new Secretary of Defense, came together to talk about just your issue of how we stay coordinated. And that area of the world where CENTCOM, AFRICOM, and EUCOM comes together, Rod Rodriguez and Lloyd Austin and I work this personally all the time to not allow seams, again, witnessed by what we just did in Kuwait. I'll turn the rest of the question over to the Secretary.
I was basically going to say the same thing, Congressman. And I think, you see, we are also trying to do things like have conferences with the chiefs of defense from all of the different countries. We have John Allen, who's working to bring together all of the coalition countries. So while it is certainly true that the membership of the coalition crosses EUCOM's AOR, CENTCOM's AOR, AFRICOM's AOR, we have a number of mechanisms in place to make sure that we're working together and that we're seeing it holistically and comprehensively and not through a soda straw.
2 second pylon, an example. I won't, to stay unclassified, I won't name the base, but we take off an ISR asset, and that ISR asset may change two or three times in the same mission who it's really supporting as we gather on targets. So this is an extremely well-orchestrated dance.
And I think that was the biggest concern that we have as a committee in regards to what's the strategy. And I think that we have been somewhat reluctant in regards to the strategy. We're gonna hear, you know, on AUMF and what is the real strategy going forward. And it's not just ISIS. This is a much broader issue of Islamic extremism. And until I think the administration actually drills down and says the words, it kind of diminishes. And what you don't want to do is give credence to the caliphate or ISIL or whatever. I think that just creates a bigger problem for us when we add legitimacy to that. And lastly, just on Ukraine, I would just say, and I agree with the chairman, it hasn't worked so far. And I understand what happens when we ratchet up and we give lethal aid to the Ukrainians. But I had a meeting last night with some Ukrainians in an off setting, and they're absolutely concerned about their loved ones that are still there and what's going to happen to them. And these folks are U.S. citizens concerned about what's going to happen. And so I would think that we have not been very successful in predicting Mr. Putin's actions, but I think our inaction is more of an appeasement than it is of showing leadership. And I yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I don't want to try y'all's patience too long. I do have just a handful of things I'd like to ask about briefly. Several people ask about NATO defense budgets. Wales Summit sets a goal, 2%. General, I know you have these conversations with your counterparts all the time in NATO. So far, do you see anybody heading up? And who is?
So, Chairman, it's a great question, and I would like to answer it in two ways. Yes, we have seen nations, including some of the Baltics that were mentioned earlier, who have made a pledge and showed a plan on how they will attain their 2% spending. Now, they're very motivated. Other nations also are in the same boat. We also, in truth, have seen a couple of nations whose administrations have changed. Remember, this was national leaders that made this commitment, and those national leaders have changed, and we see a little regression in a couple. Let me not try to pump sunshine, but point out a few good things, and that is, separate from the 2%, also important is that their militaries step up to the mission we need to do. Defense starts at home, and as we have made these three basic changes in NATO as a function of the Readiness Action Plan, RAP, we're standing up the Very High Readiness Task Force. We needed three or four nations to be center brigades for that task force. We got six volunteer nations to step up to that in our recent defense ministerials. As we stand up these six new units in our easternmost nations, they're NATO force integration units. We jokingly call them nephews. They will be the on receiving and onward movement capability of NATO nations in these countries. And we had strong pledges, again, for the manning and standing up those units. And then last but not least, the fundamental change in what we're going to expect from the multinational corps Northeast in Szczecin, Poland, which will take on that Article 5 responsibility in the East and the North. Strong manning conference and a strong pledge by the three framework nations including us, the United States, stepping up our participation in that headquarters to bring it to capability. So I painted a long picture, but the bottom line is we also asked them to step up with our forces, and to this point, they're answering, Chairman.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. One issue that I don't believe has come up today is the threat of Islamic infiltration through the Mediterranean. So we all saw or knew of this horrible beheading of Coptic Christians on the coast of Libya. There is clearly an ISIS presence there. I read that the Italians are quite concerned about what's going to come up from the south. Is NATO considering naval patrols of some sort to deal with this threat, or is it a real threat, I guess?
Chairman, it is a real threat, and it is one of the primary concerns of our southern NATO nations. I think you heard me mention a little bit earlier that coming out of Wales and every meeting since, we've had a strong recognition that we have to adapt NATO to be able to react to the north and east and the problem with the revanchist Russia, but we also have to look to the south because we have a multifaceted problem in the south from migration flows, organized crime, terror, all the problems that are occurring in the ungoverned spaces in northern Africa are bleeding across the Mediterranean in the south. And as a part of the tasking I was given in my other hat as the Supreme Allied Commander of Europe, we have to deliver a plan for addressing that. We will deliver that on the 31st of March. We delivered first the plan to address the north and the east, and next we will deliver our papers to look at the south threat as well. And you're right, Chairman, this is a multifaceted approach to include naval applications.
Okay. If I were in some of those nations, I would be concerned about how long that's taking to get a plan because these folks seem to move rather quickly. I think you may have answered this, but other than budgetary considerations, your preference would be to have a permanent stationing of forces in Eastern Europe rather than a rotational one. Is that correct?
Chairman, yes.
And it would be those Eastern European countries' preference as well.
Chairman, if I could back up and clarify what I just said.
Okay.
I'm in favor of permanent stationed forces in Europe. I think that the discussion of in our easternmost nations, this is a different discussion for all of the reasons that you understand. And does that answer?
Yeah, we'd need to go country by country is their preferences. That makes sense. Ms. Warmoth, lots of discussion about arms control and tactical nukes and so forth. But isn't it true that the Russian public doctrine is evolving to include the potential use of tactical nuclear weapons against even conventional forces, so that this potential danger by these tactical nukes that were not included in New START is taking on a little bit of a different enhanced meaning?
Chairman, I think it's fair to say that Russia is in the process of evolving its doctrine in some very important ways. I would prefer to talk to you about that in a classified session and would be happy to do that, but I think it is fair to say in an open hearing that they are making some doctrinal changes that are concerning to us and that we need to take into account as we look to how we're going to deter Russia going forward.
Yeah. Well, I'm just referring to some of the things they're publishing openly. Now, obviously, there are other conversations to have as well. Last question I've got. General, you mentioned in answer to one of the questions that talking about what the Russians learned from the Georgian invasion, and you said the Russians are a learning and adaptive force. My question is, are we? And especially as we see these hybrid tactics and all that in this theater Russia is using to advance their national interest, seems to me it presents us some really difficult challenges. And from where you sit, are we learning and adaptive to deal with these new challenges that try to strike at some of our weaknesses?
Chairman, I'd like to assure you that, yes, we are learning and adaptive. And I am encouraged by some of the things that even our young people have helped us to understand and how do we approach some of these hybrid challenges we see. There's a lot of mystique around this word, hybrid warfare. All it really is a different way to use tools that we have known about forever. The things that they bring to the table and use in a more, in a way that creates ambiguity. And so how we address those ambiguities are very important. And so that I don't give away some of the more, I would say, very ingenious ways that our young folks have worked, we'll make those available to you. But the bottom line is, yes, sir, we are a learning and adaptive force.
Well, I hope we are in a timely way. Because it's whether we're talking about the threat from terrorism, whether we're talking about what the Russians are doing, or a number of other threats around the world, adversaries seem to be moving very quickly, looking for those asymmetric advantages that they can gain against us, and looking for our weak spots. And one of our weak spots is we don't do very well with somebody who lies and cheats and does all the things that we've seen coming out of the Russians. So, but that's the world we live in, and we have to adapt. Thank you both. We've touched on a lot of subjects today. I very much appreciate you being here and appreciate the seriousness of the issues which confront each of you as well as this committee. And with that, the hearing will stand adjourned.